This 100mm macro, while optically excellent, costs about 50% less compared to similar Nikon and Canon lenses. Question is it worth the money? Hi, I'm Mike, independent camera repair technician, and I'm starting fixyourcamera.org to show you the photo gear industry from a different point of view. No specs, no marketing BS, talking about things you won't hear anywhere else. Welcome. I kept figuring out some things here and also thinking about which camera or lens should I start with for the first teardown and review. Meanwhile, I bought this macro lens, and after just a couple of days of use, it started making some weird noises, so... Instead of shipping it out, I decided to fix it myself and make a teardown and review at the same time. So Tokina M100 is the first one, problem solved. Of course, this will void my warranty, but I personally don't care about it that much. If your lens is still under the warranty, don't disassemble it. Okay, so a very quick overview of this thing. There is a manual aperture ring. There is also a focus limiting switch, and this is a very useful feature. Macro lenses are usually slow as a turtle when it comes to focusing speed, and this one makes no exception. So this switch is mechanically dividing the full range of focusing mechanism into two parts. So you can use this lens either as a regular prime lens or as a typical close-up macro lens. And in both cases, it's gonna make it focusing about 50% faster, which is not bad. 9 blades diaphragm, which is very nice, almost perfectly round. And it's mechanically controlled by this lever since it's an Nikon mount. And the optics are super clean, which is usually but not always the case with brand new lenses. Also, this is an externally focusing lens, which means that the front part moves in and out while focusing. It's not great, but as long as it doesn't rotate while doing this, it's good enough. And of course, there are also MTF charts to compare and some other things, specifications and stuff like that. But since I don't care about this, I'm not gonna talk about it here. Let's get to the problem. If I remember correctly, there is a nice thin ball bearing that goes all the way around the clutch mechanism. But probably that's not where the problem is. It's most likely somewhere here. My guess is that there is some grease missing inside this lens. Someone at the factory either got lazy or made a mistake. And even if they do have a great quality control at that factory, this type of problem is very hard to detect. And that's because most of those parts inside have some kind of paint on them, or there is some residual grease that will make this lens work perfectly fine for some usually short period of time. Or maybe it's something else. Let's see. Now, as with most Tokina lenses I've seen so far, this is a very simple and solid construction. That's why it's so heavy. It's a very simple construction when it comes to electronics also. Just a handful of SMD parts, an oscillator and an 8-bit microcontroller. There is also a manual focus switch and a position encoder, which I'm gonna show you later. This gear is getting engaged or disengaged depending on the position of the focusing clutch mechanism. Let's remove it now. Just a thin plastic shell covering some solid metal alloy parts. Even though this clutch mechanism doesn't feel right while I'm rotating it, it's most likely not directly related to my squeaky problem. So I'm gonna take care of it in a couple of minutes. Let's see what we got so far. One of the nicest looking lens mounts ever. Is it very important? No. But still, it looks so good that I just couldn't resist mentioning it. It's solid and quite heavy. Plastic manual aperture ring. Not much to it. Another plastic ring that goes under the lens mount. A thin plastic shell that goes over the clutch mechanism. And the clutch mechanism itself. This is how it looks like when removed from the lens. And here is the rest of this lens, and the problem is definitely here. I can extend the front part by rotating this black barrel, and it doesn't feel right. It's slightly loose, but that's most likely fine. But when I'm rotating it, I can definitely feel this friction. It's hard to move. Oh, and here is something else. A scratch. Two scratches. Now, usually when I see something like this, it's a big warning sign that something's wrong here. Either one of the screws got loose and is getting stuck between these two barrels, causing this type of scratch, or one of those barrels is out of shape. It's not perfectly round, and while moving, it's touching onto something else. But in this case, I cannot see anything that could cause these scratches. So maybe, in order to machine these helicoid grooves within this barrel, they are using some kind of a mounting tool at the factory, and this tool is causing this type of scratches. I don't know. Let's continue and remove this front tube and the outer barrel. And this friction is still here, but I feel like I'm getting close to it. Looks like this ring here prevents the helicoid barrel from sliding out. It was kind of a stuck in place, which is common for these. It's very important if you're gonna be working on your lens, not necessarily this model, but any lens, not to force anything. There are ways to get these things unstuck and get them moving gently. And I think I'm gonna record another video just about this subject. Okay, so everything is clear now. It was exactly what I suspected from the beginning. Not even a trace amount of grease. These parts are completely brand new with absolutely nothing applied to them. Same thing here. This barrel moves over this edge over here. And this edge is completely dry with nothing on it. So yeah, no wonder it was making those terrible noises. So I'll have to apply something to it. But overall, this lens looks pretty good inside. Not many plastic parts, well, actually there are no plastic parts inside this lens whatsoever. Just the outer shell is made of plastic. And it's not like plastic parts are always bad or something, but still I love to see this type of old school primitive construction. Primitive in a good way. Solid and simple. And as I said before, when it comes to electronics, there is just this mount connector, an 8-bit microcontroller, and a focus position encoder, and also there is this manual focus switch. And that's all there is to it. No GMR sensor, no silent wave ultrasonic motor, no VR or image stabilization system, no diaphragm flex cable. Super, super simple. I'm trying to set up a microscope here with a camera so that I can show you some interesting things in future videos, but so far I'm having problems with it. A DSLR coupled with a microscope makes the depth of field so shallow that it's actually very hard to show anything sharp and in focus. I think I'm gonna have to try with some kind of a camcorder with a tiny sensor, image stabilization and possibly autofocus. It might actually work much better than a DSLR. Oh, and if you have some good idea about a camera or camcorder that actually works very well with a microscope, please let me know. Now, let's take a look at the diaphragm assembly here. It looks good, kinda old school, but there is one part I don't like right away. And it's this manual adjustment ring. But before I tell you why I don't like it, let me give you a quick tip here. Diaphragm assemblies are not always easy to put back together. Especially if you have completely no experience with them. And with this one, judging by its construction, it might be necessary to adjust it after reassembly. And you can do it at home without any additional tools, just by using your camera body. And you can get it pretty accurate within 1/3 of a stop, or possibly better depending on how you're gonna do it. However, my point here is that if you don't absolutely have to disassemble it, don't do it. And save yourself some trouble and time. Now back to this part. This ring is made of brass, or some similar kind of alloy. That's because of its self-lubricating properties, which means that it can work without any kind of grease. And in case of diaphragm assembly, it's a very good thing. But because brass is a gold-colored shiny metal, it has to be darkened before putting it into a lens. Otherwise, it would cause reflections and some other light problems. And this is achieved by putting those brass parts into some chemical, I think it's some kind of an acid. And it makes those parts very dark, brown, pretty much black color. Then they have to be cleaned and they are ready to go. So they look like this. Or this. Now, this ring is not dark. Probably it's good enough. But more important is that it's not clean. It has a lot of this brown powder on it, and this dust or brown powder over time could make its way into optics. I just don't like it. I'm not going to paint it or darken it in any other way, however, it could definitely benefit from cleaning. For now, let's go back to this clutch assembly. It's not working correctly, it just doesn't feel right. And I bet that you already know what the problem is. Here are two rings. One on the left is metal and one on the right is plastic. And they are held together by a screw lock, which is kind of a glue. And by a piece of tape, which I removed previously. Not the best way of holding two parts stuck together, I think. These metal tabs are acting as springs. And under them, there are small plastic balls. These balls are actually responsible for making this clicking noise when you switch auto to manual focus. Front plastic ring. And under that plastic ring, there are two brass rollers. And this is also not the type of design I love to see. These are secured by small screws with tiny threads into a thin aluminum piece. Now, I don't want you to worry about this too much, but I hope you can see why you should be gentle with the clutch mechanism on Tokina lenses. Especially if you are in the manual focus mode. If you are turning the focusing ring by hand, there is a point where it stops. Don't force it past that point. Moving on. Here is the ball bearing I told you about at the beginning. And of course there is no sign of any kind of lubricant whatsoever. But when it comes to design, I like it. It's very nice. Now, since I have everything disassembled, here is what I think about this lens. There are six plastic parts, not counting the focusing window and two rampers. This one is half plastic and half metal. And they are all outer shell, mechanically not important. Everything else is metal alloys and it's quite solid. Overall, it's a very simple and solid construction. When it comes to optics, there are just two assemblies, as you can see here. One in the back is fixed, which means that it stays in the same position at all times, and this one moves in and out while focusing. There is no zoom mechanism, there are no complicated helicoids, again, very simple construction. I like this gear assembly. Plastic gears are a common failure point in many kit lenses or many cheap prime lenses. One broken tooth and it stops working. Here it's all metal and very solid. Overall, it's a nice lens. Especially if you consider that it's only half the price of Canon's or Nikon's 100mm macros. And if you, like me, don't need any image stabilization, I'm gonna use two powerful strobes anyway, I think it could be a very good choice. Despite of the clutch mechanism, which I think is a weak spot in Tokina lenses, but if you're careful and gentle with it, it should last many years without any problems. When it comes to repairs, I would say it's not the easiest one, but still rather easy to disassemble and put back together. And Tokina is the only third party lens manufacturer that I was actually able to get the parts from in the past. It's not as easy as with Canon, that you just call them, tell them the part number and your credit card number and you get the part within 2 days or so. But still, you can talk them into selling you parts that you need. Well, at least in the States, I'm not sure how it works in other countries. Now about all of this grease messing. I don't know how they managed to do that, but I know from experience that mistakes do happen for every single camera and lens manufacturer. Every single one. And compared to other things and products that I'm gonna show you in the future, while annoying, it's really not such a big deal. But yes, they could have done a better job at the factory. Overall, it's way more important how the manufacturer responds to such problems and if they are fixing them quickly or not. I'm pretty sure that Tokina would fix it for me for free under the warranty, no problem, but I wanted to do a teardown and review of this lens anyway, so I did it myself. And I'm gonna repeat this again, if your lens is still under the warranty, please do not disassemble it and send it to Tokina instead. Okay, so a final test here, before I put those rubbers and focusing window back in place. And it's smooth, and nice. And that's exactly how it should be from the very beginning. So overall, I'm gonna keep this one. I like it now. And all high-res pictures that you'll see on fixyourcamera.org website in the future will be coming from this exact lens. Also, a very important thing here. I don't want you to get an overall impression from watching this video that every time something is squeaky or doesn't work properly within your camera or lens, it's the grease missing that's causing this. In fact, I would say most of the time it's not the case. One popular example here is ultrasonic motors. They do get squeaky over time, and there are ways of dealing with this problem. If you apply a tiny amount of grease to it, even a thin film of grease from your finger from touching it, it can stop it from working completely. And one of those ultrasonic motors, especially the ring type, the larger one, can set you back several hundred dollars easily, so please don't do it. Okay, so thanks for watching, hope you enjoyed it. More videos coming soon, so I'll see you next time.